When solving problems using the work energy principle, it helps usually to draw a free body diagram for the forces acting on an object, because that often comes into play. And then you want to determine if each force does work over the displacement you're considering in your diagram. Keep track of the signs, because that matters whether things are doing positive work or negative work. Next, we add up the total amount of work done by each force and set it equal to the change in kinetic energy to solve for whatever unknown we're trying to solve for. I'll go ahead and write in here to remind ourselves that we can express this as my initial kinetic energy plus the work to take me from state A to state B is equal to my final kinetic energy. And then, as always, we check our answers. Here we have a couple of interesting notes. If our object's traveling at a constant speed, the total work should be zero, because it hasn't sped up or slowed down. If the change here is zero, then the work should be zero. If the total work is positive, then we should have more kinetic energy at the end, so we should have sped up. And if the total work is negative, then we should have less kinetic energy at the end, so we should have slowed down. That's the general process for solving work energy problems. Let's try it. Here we have a frictionless track for a toy car, including a loop-de-loop of a certain radius r. We want to know how high, measured from the bottom of the loop, must the car be placed to start from rest on the approaching section of track and go all the way around the loop. All right, let's consider this. What that means is that we have to, at this top point of the loop, have some velocity at that point too, to get us all the way around. So we want to know, what's this original height y1 in order that we have enough velocity to make it around at that point too? Let's begin as we said we would, by doing a free body diagram on the car at that point 2 that we care about. So at point 2, we have our car, and it will have the force of gravity acting down on it. It will have some velocity, v2, and it might have some normal force, but the normal force can only push. It's not pulling it back on. It's not strapped in somehow. There are no rails here. So this normal force can be greater than or equal to zero. So in the limit where it's just barely staying on the track, it's not exerting any normal force on it. And the sums of those forces have to equal mass times acceleration. And we need a certain mass times acceleration to make our way around. So this mass times acceleration is going to be the centripetal acceleration. Using this, a Newton's second law, we can say, here I'll call down positive to make my life easy, the sums of the forces here on the left have to equal this mass times centripetal acceleration. If it's just about to fall, then this normal force here will end up being zero. So it's normal force plus weight is equal to mass times my centripetal acceleration is v squared over r. Let's go ahead and be explicit about this and say this normal force is zero because we're considering the case where it's just about to fall. Now we can solve for the thing we want to know, v squared. And in this case, actually, since this is at state 2, I can say that this is v2. So we'll divide both sides by m, it cancels the m, multiply by r, and take the square root to get, well, let's not take the square root. Let's just say v2 squared is equal to g times r, and leave it there for right now. So that's the free body diagram, analyzing that to try and get some information about our problem. Now let's apply the work energy principle. The work energy principle says that the work to get from state 1 to state 2 is equal to the difference in kinetic energies between my final and my initial state. That means that we have 1 half mv2 squared minus 1 half mv1 squared. This v1 is starting from rest, which means that this will end up being 0. Now let's look at the work being done on this. The only work that's coming into this is from gravity. The work done by gravity is negative mg times my final position minus my initial position. Now this equals 1/2 mv2 squared. It's looking promising. We can divide both sides by mass. And now we can substitute in for our v2 squared. So we'll substitute in and rewrite this as negative g times y2 minus y1 is equal to 1/2 times gr. If you don't like substituting in a squared term, you can take the square root, substitute it in, and then square it again. But it's the same. Now, we can divide by g on both sides. And remember, the thing we want to know is we want to know what y1 is. So let's keep doing some algebra and see if we can get there. I'm going to distribute this negative to get negative y2 plus y1 is equal to 1/2 the radius. Continuing on, we can say by adding y2 to both sides that y1 is equal to y2 plus 1/2 r. Go ahead and continue up here. We know that y2 is equal to twice r because it's double the radius of this loop. So that's 2r plus 1/2 r. 2r is 4/2 r, so we get y1 being equal to 5/2 r. And that's what it is, right? That's the answer. So how high, measured from the bottom of the loop, must the car be placed? Well, the car must be placed, here we can even use one of these symbols, greater than or equal to 5/2, or if you prefer, 2.5 times the radius of that loop to make it around. In practice, I would expect that if you actually tried this, you could not get your car to go around that loop. And if you think about it, you might be able to figure out why. If you place it right at that limit, you're going to have friction. This analysis was assuming no friction. With friction, you would not be able to make it around. So you'll probably need to be not just 2.5R, but maybe 3R, 4R, something enough to overcome whatever friction is present in reality.